I'll hug them and send them home.
Well, amen. That was wonderful. You know, it's amazing the message of that song, talking about believers. Of course, it's limited to believers, but if you're saved tonight, your chains, your shackles have been set free. You're no longer in bondage to your sin. But it's amazing to me how often we as believers, we go back to our sin. And it's kind of like every now and then we'll put our little dog on a chain, let him stay outside for a little while. And as soon as you unhook him from that chain, he runs free. He runs wild. But he doesn't ever run back to the chain and say, "Put me back on the chain." But you know what? A lot of times that's what we do as believers. We run right back to our sin, and well, praise God, one day we'll be delivered from these bodies, and that battle that we have with sin will be no more. And so thank you, Mark and Sister Jan, for your work with our children, teaching them these wonderful songs. And I tell you, those are some great messages in those songs. You know, the world is constantly pumping all kinds of junk into our children's minds. And that is the kind of stuff that we need to be giving our children. So thank you so much. Well, tonight, if you remember last week, I started a series talking about waste-free living. And I was talking to you about the fact that as believers, we've been called for a purpose, and that this life down here is not meant to be wasted as believers. There is a reason why God has not called us home yet. He has something for us to do. And so often, though, if we're not careful, we just kind of go through life and we just waste life. We waste that which God has given us to live for Him. If you had to sum it up, what is probably the greatest goal or the greatest reason we're all alive today as believers? What do you think our greatest purpose is? To share the good news, certainly, very good. But why do we share the good news? What is the central focus, the central meaning of life for us as believers? To bring glory. The Westminster Catechism says the chief end of man is to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. And that being based off 1 Corinthians 10:31, which says, "Whether you eat or drink, or whatsoever you do for the glory of God." And so for as believers, everything is about living for His glory. And as I said last week, we don't have a whole lot of time as believers. As James said in the book of James, life is like a vapor. You know, we're getting into some cooler weather, and you know what it's like when you get in your car in the morning, you crank on the car, and you see that vapor coming out of your exhaust. It's just there for a moment, and then it's gone. And that's the way life is. We don't have a whole lot of time, and so we don't need to waste life. And so last week was kind of an introduction, and for the next several weeks, I just want to talk about different aspects of life that we focus on so that we don't waste our life. And tonight, I want to talk to us. I say us because... As a way of a preface to this message, I'm not preaching at you. I am preaching to myself. But tonight I want to talk about using our bodies for God's glory. Or you could put it this way, not wasting your life. Not wasting your life through not taking care of your body. So using your body for God's glory. I read about a man. He's a 33-year-old man, and he has spent nearly $100,000, and that's a lot of money, especially for a 33-year-old man. $100,000 in order to make himself look like Justin Bieber. How about that? He's gone through over 5 years of series of surgeries, plastic surgeries, in order to make himself look like Justin Bieber. He's had hair transplants, things done to his eyes. I like this one. He had a smile surgery to where his lips and his mouth were reconstructed so that when he smiled, he looked like Justin Bieber. And I read that, and my reaction was just like you. I laughed, but then it hit me. I thought, you know, is that why God gave us our bodies? So that we can spend a lot of money and time in order to make ourselves look like somebody else. And you know, really, we are in the process of working towards looking more and more like somebody else. But it's not Justin Bieber. It's Jesus Christ. And so tonight I want to talk to us about being careful not to take care of our bodies. Being careful to take care of our bodies so that our bodies bring glory to God. You know, back in Paul's time, there was all kinds of false teaching. And you know what? It hadn't changed. There's a whole lot of false teaching today. That's just the way it is. Going all the way back through the history of time, you see there's always been a lie. You go all the way to the Garden of Eden, and you see a lie. Satan taking truth and twisting it in order to spread lies. And in Paul's day, there were false teachings that constantly plagued the churches, and it brought Paul to tears. We found that a couple weeks ago in the book of Philippians, when Paul thought about the damage that those false teachers were bringing into the churches. And some of that teaching was known as Gnosticism, this idea of our need to have this special revelation. We need to have this special revelation, and it's through this revelation, through this knowledge, that we gain salvation. And part of Gnosticism involved dualism. And basically, without going into a whole lot of details, dualism was this idea that anything material is evil. Anything material is evil, and the only thing that you really need to be concerned about is your spirit. Don't even worry about your body, because your body is corrupt. And so the only thing that God is concerned about is your spirit. So in essence, you can do anything in your body, because that doesn't matter. So your body doesn't matter. It's just your spirit. And so what was happening here at the church at Corinth, and by the way, we're going back to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And we're going to look at verses 19 through 20. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And really this section begins in verse 12 of 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And let's start in verse 12. Let's just read these verses. Paul says, "All things are lawful for me, but not all things are helpful. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. Food's for the stomach, and the stomach for the food. But God will destroy both it and them. Now the body is not for sexual immorality, but for the Lord. And the Lord is for the body. And God both raised up the Lord, and will also raise up by His power. And us will also be raised up by His power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a harlot? Certainly not. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a harlot is one body with her? For the two, he says, shall become one flesh. But he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. Flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does is outside the body, but he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? For you were bought at a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." And so here it is. Paul is talking to the church at Corinth. The church at Corinth had a lot of issues. And probably the greatest issue at the church at Corinth was they were so driven by their flesh. It was the passion of the flesh. And so there was all kinds of sexual immorality going on at this church. And so Paul writes these verses to admonish them about how they were using their body and they were sinning against the Lord because they were involved in all sorts of sexually immoral things. But what you could do with this text is, while the direct context, Paul is talking about sexual immorality, you can still use verses 19 through 20 as a principal text that teaches us that we are to use our bodies, the bodies that God has given us, for His glory. He says there in verse 20 that you are to use your spirit and your body for God's glory. We're made up of two parts, your spirit and your body. We are to worship the Lord with our spirit. Jesus said we should worship Him in spirit and in truth. So we worship Him with our spirit, but also with our body. So God intended us to use our bodies for His glory. So what you do in your body does matter, contrary to what the false teaching of Paul's day taught. Yes, it matters what we do with our bodies. It does. Some people say, well, you know, what does it matter? I mean, you know, God knows when we're going to die. I mean, He's in control of this thing, and heaven's really not such a bad place to go. So what's the big deal? In fact, I heard about this man and woman, and they were health nuts. And literally, they ate nuts. They were healthy. And they go to heaven, and they're walking in heaven, and they're just talking back, and they're just looking at the glories of heaven, and the wife looks at the man, and she says, of course, that's bad theology, by the way, but just go along with the illustration. They're just saying, wow, this is just such a glorious place. And the husband says, yeah, just think, if we hadn't eaten all those granola bars, we would have been here 10 years earlier. But yes, it does matter. God wants us to use our bodies for His glory. He wants us to take care of our bodies so that we honor Him. And again, I'm careful with this because this is not something that I'm preaching at you. I know that we're coming into the holiday season. Okay? And in fact, I'm going to go ahead and give the invitation. After church, we're going to meet at Hardee's. Anybody is welcome to come. Right, Brother Mike? We're going to meet at Hardee's. So I'm not trying to throw a damper on anybody's fun. But I think you know where I'm going at with this. We have to be careful that we take care of our bodies so that we glorify the Lord with our bodies, so that we don't throw away our life because we didn't protect our bodies. Okay, so there's a couple things I want to mention as we think about using our bodies for His glory. Number one, think biblically regarding your body. Think biblically regarding your body. Understand what God says about your body. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. That's what it says here in the text. Verse 20 says, do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God? And you are not your own. Now let me just chase a little rabbit here for just a moment. If you are saved, you have the Holy Spirit. Paul said in Romans chapter 8, he said, any man that does not have the Spirit is not a child of God. That's important to know, because some will teach that in order for you can be saved, but then you have to have a second blessing in order to gain the Spirit. That's a lie. We get the Spirit at the moment of salvation. The moment you repent of your sins and you turn from your sins and you turn to Jesus Christ, which that's repentance, by the way, that's change. Once you turn to Jesus and you've accepted His forgiveness, at that moment the Holy Spirit of God comes and lives inside of you. All right? Now, it says here that your body is the temple. Of course, Paul is borrowing from the Old Testament here. What was the purpose of the temple? What did people go to the temple for? Worship. That's the purpose of the temple. So when you think of your body, think of worship. God gave us our bodies in order to house the Spirit of God for worship. So we should use our bodies for worship. So your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Your body ultimately is designed, is intended by God to glorify His name. Going back to 1 Corinthians 10:31, whatever you do all for the glory of God. So your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Number two, your body does not belong to you. See, he says that here. He says in verse 20, "For you were bought at a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." Now, as a quick review from last week, I told you that when Jesus Christ died on the cross, something actually happened in that moment. When Jesus hung on the cross and He bore your sins on His body, He purchased you. He paid your sin debt, a debt, by the way, that you earned. You know, the moment you come into this world, you are born a sinner. And one sin earns a debt against God that you cannot pay yourself. The only one that could pay that sin for you was Jesus Christ. And so when He died on the cross, He paid for your sin and He bought you. So your body, our bodies, our physical bodies, do not belong to us. So if something has been given to you, we are to be good what? Stewards. We're to be good stewards. Now, if you saw me take out a $100 bill and just wad it up and throw it in a trash can, you would probably just gasp. Because that's a bad steward. Right? But as believers, so often we go through this life and we're not being good stewards of our bodies. And we forget that our bodies don't belong to us. You see, when you receive Christ, yes, He becomes your Savior, but He also becomes your Lord. And so you now belong to Jesus. And so we don't really have an option. We are told to take care of our bodies because our bodies belong to the Lord. So number one, think biblically regarding your body. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit if you're a Christian, and your body belongs to the Lord. It doesn't belong to you. So really, we don't have a right to abuse our bodies. Number two, not only should we think biblically regarding our bodies, but we should act biblically regarding our bodies. All right, now this is where we get real just day-to-day application here. All right, if we're going to act biblically regarding our bodies, number one, we're going to treat it right. We're going to treat it right. Well, how are you going to treat your body right? Well, you're going to exercise it. You're going to exercise it, which takes commitment. And that goes against your flesh. As I've said before, when we think of the enemy, we think of Satan and his demons. And that's true. And they oppose our walk with the Lord. But every one of us has another enemy, and it's called our flesh. And we battle against the flesh. And so to get out and exercise and take care of our bodies, you're going to have to battle against your flesh. How many of you like just running until you feel like you're going to get sick? Don't like that. Your flesh does not like that. But that's the way we're going to take care of our body. So we have to exercise it. We have to take care of it. We have to rest it. Exercise it, rest it. Who gave us a great example of that? Jesus. When Jesus walked this earth. Yes, He was God, but He was also fully man. And you see in the Gospels where there was times that Jesus took a nap. He rested His body. And I'm convinced that one of the reasons why we have some of the problems that we have, whether it's physically or emotionally, is because we're just simply not getting enough rest. And we do, like I find myself doing sometimes, I stay up too late watching. Well, last night I was watching a ball game. Okay? You know, when I was in South Carolina, I took a lot of abuse because I was the only Georgia Bulldog, and I had to deal with the Clemson Tigers and the South Carolina Gamecocks. Now I come down here, It's Alabama, it's Auburn, and FSU. But we have to be careful that we get enough rest for our bodies. So rest it. Are you getting enough rest? Are you taking times, physically enough sleep? But also, are you getting away just from the daily routine? All right, now I'm not saying, you know, that your life is one big vacation. We all need to have times where we just get away. Get away. And leave the cell phone at the house. Right? Can you imagine life without Facebook? Holy moly, what did we ever do? Rest. Get away from just the hustle and bustle of life. Also, not only should we rest it, but we need to protect it. So, we have to be careful what we put into our bodies. Harmful substances. And this is where, as Baptists, we say amen. You know, we don't need to smoke. We don't need to drink harmful beverages. We just, you know, we don't need to do illicit drugs. All those things. And all those things are true. We have to be careful. We have to protect our bodies. All right? So exercise it, protect it. Also, not only you to treat it right, which involves all those things, but you need to feed it right. Now, this is where, as Baptists, we kind of get a little quiet. It's easy to say amen towards those things that we don't struggle with. But when we get to where the rubber really meets the road, that's where it gets difficult. So if we're going to protect our bodies so that we can use our bodies for His glory and not waste our life, we need to feed it right. This involves quality. Quality food that we eat, and also probably the biggest thing that all of us struggle with. Well, I shouldn't say all of us. Maybe you don't struggle with this. But something that I struggle with, I'll be flat honest with you. You know what? I can think about an all-you-can-eat buffet bar and 2 pounds come on. I mean, that's just the way it is. But quantity. We live in a day that obesity, even in our children, it's rampant because we're not walking in the Spirit and we're not being careful to control the portions that we eat. So we have to be careful that we feed it right. We feed it right. Number three, use it right. Use your bodies correctly. Now in this text, Paul, again, is speaking directly about sexual immorality. And you know what? I wish I could say that this was only a problem in Paul's day, but it's a huge problem in our day. And let me say this. Paul was writing to the what at Corinth? The church. Paul is not talking to unbelievers here. He's talking to Christians. But he says, do not use your body for sexual immorality. Or, to give another term, for fornication. Okay? Fornication is any sort of sexual sin done outside of the covenant of marriage between a husband and a wife. So that can be physically, certainly. That can be visually. And I said this several Wednesday nights ago, but pornography in America and in the church is destroying our families. It's destroying our churches. And it's not just with men, it's with women too. And I wonder tonight, perhaps you have a struggle with that. So you can use your bodies incorrectly, sexually, regarding physically, visually, and mentally, the things you think about. Okay, so use your body right. Don't abuse your body, like Paul says here regarding sexual immorality. All right, and then finally, when it comes to our bodies, we need to view it right. Now, let me explain what I mean by this. Your body is to be used for worship, not to worship. You understand what I'm saying there? We are to take care of our bodies so that we are better worshipers of God. We don't take care of our bodies so that we can worship our bodies. We live in a day when, today, where, I mean, there's all kinds of things that you can do to get physically fit. I mean, we have milkshakes, we have everything. And yes, do we need to eat right? Do we need to exercise? Absolutely. But if we're not careful, we can take it to the extreme and we ultimately worship ourselves. Which, by the way, you know what that's called? Idolatry. Okay? And so you have to be careful that there's the right balance. There was a time in my life, and I know some of you have heard my testimony, but there was a time in my life where it was completely out of balance for me. Of course, I wasn't saved. But being physically fit and everything, that was my God. And so I worshiped me instead of worshiping the Creator. So we have to be careful that we view our bodies correctly. Yes, we want to take care of them. We want our bodies to be physically fit and healthy so that we're better worshipers of God. Remember what 1 Timothy 4:8 says? Does anybody know what that says? Somebody look it up. 1 Timothy 4:8. Anybody have it? All right, brother, read it.
For bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness is profitable for all things. Having promised of
That's good. You've read far enough. So you say, praise God, I don't have to worry about exercising. That's not what Paul's saying. He's saying what I was just saying. He says, be careful. Don't get things out of balance. Okay. I know, and perhaps you've been around people like this who are very, very healthy. I mean, they are very conscientious of what they eat. They're very conscientious of exercise and all that sort of thing. But they're very unhealthy to be around because they're just not fun to be around. They're just miserable. I mean, I was around a guy, and he's a Christian. He was very fit. And he saw somebody eating a donut, and he was like, a donut? It was like they had committed the unpardonable sin. And so you have to keep things in balance. All right, two words of quick application. Number one, when I am healthy, I can better serve the Lord. Pretty simple. When I am healthy, I can better serve the Lord. So there's better quality to my service because I have more energy. I can do more. And there's better quantity. There's stamina. All right. When we're out of shape, we're limited on what we can do for the King, for the Master. Did you know the International Mission Board, which, by the way, our cooperative dollars go to support. So right now we are supporting missionaries out on the mission field. There are weight requirements that they have. So before you can go out on the mission field, if you are overweight, if you're obese, you can't go over. And there's several reasons for that. Number one, just for the physical aspects, but also because of the testimony. Okay. So when I am healthy, I can better serve the Lord. Number two, when I am healthy, I can better testify for the Lord. Jesus said we are to be the light of the world. So everything in our life, the things that we say, the things that we do, our testimonies should point people to Jesus Christ. And here's the deal. If we're overweight and it is evident to the world, it's a bad testimony. It's just not a good testimony. Okay? And so we need to take care of our bodies so that the testimony that we give off points people to Jesus. Maybe it's not just an overweight thing. Maybe it's how we're using our bodies. And the world looks at that and they see that and they say, well, if that's what Christianity's about, I don't want to have anything to do with it. Okay. Romans 12:1 says, I appeal to you, therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. So Paul says to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. And so I just close tonight with this question. Am I, and here we are, we need to get very, just between you and the Lord, am I using my body for God's glory? Am I doing what is necessary, what God would expect of me, to use my physical body to bring glory and His honor and honor to His name? And if I'm not, then what do I need to do? Well, if there's an area of your life that the Holy Spirit of God is showing you that you're not taking care of your body, you need to first of all repent. What does repent mean? That's not a real popular word, by the way. But what does it mean to repent? Turn. Stop doing it. Okay? Change. Stop doing it. And don't make excuses. Well, I know I'm overweight, but you know, it's just those genetics and my thyroid and all these things. And don't misunderstand me. I understand that there are certain things that are out of some people's control and they just can't help it. So don't misunderstand my heart. But a lot of times, we're just making excuses for our sins. Perhaps the reason why our thyroid is messed up is because we're not taking care of our bodies. Okay? So if we're going to get right with God, we have to be honest with God. And we can't make excuses. And above everything else, we have to ask God for help. We can't do it. I love, this is very convicting. I love it, but it's very convicting. In the book of Galatians, Paul spells out the fruits of the Spirit. Does anybody know what the very last fruit of the Spirit is? Self-control. That is just amazing to me. And the Spirit of God, sometimes, after I've gone through the buffet line one time and I've mounded it over, and then I'm sitting there and I'm about ready to go the second time, that rings in my ear. Self-control. And so I'm going to make a statement. Our physical health is an indicator of our spiritual health. You can't separate the two. Because if one of the fruits of the Spirit is self-control, and that tells me that through the power that He provides, we can push away, we can avoid doing things with our bodies that may bring us pleasure, but dishonor the Lord, and we can do it for His glory. And you know what I have found? When I am walking in the Spirit, and I choose to be obedient, and I say, okay, I'm not going to eat that second piece of cake. I want to so bad, and it would taste really good. But I'm going to be obedient to the Lord, and I'm going to walk away from it. In the end, there's much more gratification and pleasure in being obedient than being disobedient. Because God honors it. So tonight, my challenge to all of us, notice I say us, let us use our bodies for His glory, and let us not waste our lives because we're not protecting our bodies. Let's pray. Father, Lord, we thank You, Lord Jesus, for giving us the physical bodies that You've given us. Lord, when we study the body, it's just absolutely miraculous. And how can we, as we study the dynamics of the body and how detailed it is, how can we say that there is no God? That Your hand is all over Your creation. Lord, we thank You that You've given us our bodies, and Lord, we want to use our bodies for Your glory. We don't do these things so that we can somehow earn Your favor and earn our salvation, but we want to be good stewards of our bodies because of our salvation, so that our bodies will bring glory and honor to Your name, so that we can serve You more effectively, so that we can do more things for Your glory, so that if You call us to go out on the mission field, we can do it. Lord, we just want to be open and available to You, and we don't want to have anything in our lives that is hindering our service to you. Lord, if there's anything that we're doing in the way of our physical bodies that's bringing harm to our bodies and ultimately harm to the testimony of Christ, Lord, show it to us so that we can repent of it, so that we can turn to you for help, and in your strength and your power, live obedient lives. Lord, we thank you for your love for us, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,